I would like to remember some words of St. Francis of Assisi, which I think are really just particularly apt at the moment. Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
Margaret Thatcher on the steps of Downing Street on her election to power 20 years ago this week. But did she then go on to betray her promise of unity and the British people? Tonight, Margaret Thatcher goes on trial. Good evening. May the 3rd, 1979 was a turning point in the history of Britain. The electorate went to the polls after five troubled years of Labour government and voted for a politician offering a distinct change. Few can have imagined just how significant that change was to be. Tonight, its architect, Margaret Thatcher, stands accused of betraying the British people by promoting greed over compassion, the haves over the have-nots, leaving a country divided. Now, deciding her guilt or innocence, a studio jury of 250 drawn from around Britain and selected to represent the nation as a whole. Now, the team for the prosecution are radical journalist B. Campbell, who's written extensively about life on the breadline in Margaret Thatcher's Britain, and Gerald Kaufman, who fought Mrs. Thatcher throughout the 1980s from the opposition front bench as both shadow home and foreign secretary. Gerald Kaufman, your case.
A young mother with her baby begging in Euston Tube Station. In every doorway in the Strand, homeless people sleep in cardboard boxes. Thousands of teenage boys leave their homes after income support for 16 to 18-year-olds is abolished. Some go on the streets as rent boys. Negative equity becomes widespread. People who can't keep up mortgage payments find the sale value of their homes is less than they owe. Bosses of certain privatized industries pay themselves seven-figure salaries and bonuses, far more than their employees will earn in a lifetime. This is a picture of Thatcher's Britain, and it wasn't like that before Thatcher became Prime Minister.
For the defense, we have Bruce Anderson, one of Fleet Street's more pugnacious columnists and an early convert to Mrs. Thatcher's project, and John Redwood, who ran her policy unit, giving her popular capitalism as a policy for the 1980s. He remains a keen advocate of the enterprise culture. John Redwood, your defense.
Members of the jury, during the 1980s, the poor got richer. Margaret Thatcher cut tax rates, but the rich paid a lot more tax as the decade advanced. Success brought success. The extra tax revenue was used for improvements in the public services and more benefits. She changed Britain for the better. She widened ownership. Many bought their own homes. Many bought shares in the companies they worked for. She gave new opportunities to those on lower incomes. She rescued Britain from the anarchy and strikes of the 1970s from the Labour liberal Britain she inherited. She put the winter of discontent well and truly behind us with her great reforms. She led an enterprise revolution which transformed us into one of the most successful economies in the world. She put the great back into Great Britain. Find her guilty tonight, and you find the British people guilty because we voted her in and re-elected her on three separate occasions, three election victories.
Now, at the heart of the decision of whether Margaret Thatcher's innocent or guilty of the charge is the question of what she set out to achieve. Prosecution, call your first witness, please.
Lawrence Marks and Maurice Gran.
Marks and Gran are the millionaire writing team behind some of television's most famous sitcoms, including Birds of a Feather.
Now then, in theory, you two ought to be emblems of Thatcherism, monuments to her success. Your success, you're incredibly rich, should be her success. Is that how it is? Do you feel yourself to be the embodiment of Thatcherism?
We were lucky. We were in the right place at the right time. But the fact that we did well doesn't mean that we stopped being interested and caring about other people, which is what I think Margaret Thatcher wanted us to. She wanted people to do better and cut themselves off from the people who were less well off.
Why would you care about those who don't thrive, those who are defeated, those who have no money?
I think I ought to say, because we're not Thatcherists. I mean...
Why not?
That's the divide. I mean, to be crude about it, if you care, you can't be a Thatcherite, in my opinion.
Let me stop you there and bring in, the defence, Bruce Anderson.
I want a tax regime where people become wealthy through hard work, risk and success. That's what Margaret Thatcher said. What's so wrong with that?
I do believe that the fact that the tax regime was reformed for the better doesn't defend the entire morality or lack of morality of the Thatcher years.
Perhaps you live in a kind of sitcom political world. I mean, if she was... But if she was such a divisive figure, why is there so much ideological convergence now in British politics?
But that doesn't make her moral.
It makes her realistic.
But it doesn't make her moral.
But morals that have no basis in reality are no way to live.
Politics which have no basis in morality are no politics.
Lawrence Marks and Maurice Grant, thank you both very much. Thank you, Bruce Anderson. John Redwood, would you please call your first witness for the defence?
I have pleasure in calling Michael Dobbs.
Michael Dobbs is now a best-selling author, but in the mid-1980s, he was right-hand man to Norman Tebbit at Conservative Party Central Office.
Michael, can you please remind us how poor, how divided, how strife-ridden, how unsuccessful Britain was in the 1970s?
Britain at that time was commonly called the sick man of Europe. It was in chaos. We had schools closed because of strike action. We had ambulance men on strike. The dustbins weren't collected. We even had the obscenity of picket lines around hospitals turning away sick patients and hospital wards being emptied, sending cancer patients home to die. That's why Britain insisted on a change. Change had to come.
Gerald Crawford.
Mr. Dobbs, it's very nice to see you, and of course, as we all know, you are a brilliant writer of fiction, and we just heard the way you do it.
Has to be one of the cheapest shots for a serious debate, but anyway, please go ahead.
When it comes to cheap shots, Mr. Dobbs, I think you and I can be great friends.
Great.
Are you aware that by 1990, which was the year that her party kicked her out, national income per head in Britain was below that of every European Union country except Ireland, Spain, Portugal and Greece?
I won't dicker with statistics with you because we all know what statistics can mean. Let me give you another fact, Mr. Coffin, if I may. Not a statistic, but a reality. It wasn't Margaret Thatcher who stood on bridges above motorways and threw lumps of concrete onto people for the heinous crime during the miners' strike of wanting to go to work. That was the reality of left-wing extremism in those years.
Mr. Dobbs, I don't think you're focusing yourself on what this is about. This is not a trial of left-wing extremists. If it were, I would be a prosecutor of them. This is a trial of Margaret Thatcher. Did you know that when Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister, the rate of insolvencies was 5,000 a year? And when she was kicked out by her own party, it was 15,000. The number of insolvencies multiplied by three. And that was because of the recessions that she provoked twice.
You can pluck as many statistics out of the air as you want, but you cannot deal with the fact that Margaret Thatcher won time and time and time again. And the real, you see, the real viciousness, the real lack of caring were in all of those strikes, the selfish pay claims of 35% at times, which were promoted by the fact that a Labour government had, through its incompetence, had simply not managed to run the economy in anything like a proper fashion. It was a shambles.
Prime Minister for 11 years, and you're blaming everybody else for what she did.
I'm not blaming her.
Michael Dobbs, thank you very much. And as I think you can see from the case that's developing, Margaret Thatcher saw trades union militancy as one of the key obstacles to achieving her vision of a free enterprise Britain.
I think we went through a period
when too many people began to expect their standard of living to be guaranteed by the state. And so great protest movements came that you could, by having sufficient protests, sufficient demonstrations against government, get somehow a larger share for yourself. And they looked at the protests and the demonstrations and the strikes to get a bigger share for them. But it always had to come from the people who really strive to do more and to do better.
But did her trades union reforms, designed to free up enterprise, end up promoting greed over compassion whilst disempowering the many low-paid and unemployed? Prosecution, your witness.
I call Lord Murray, Lionel Murray, former General Secretary of the Trades Union Congress.
Len Murray was TUC General Secretary for the first 5 years of Margaret Thatcher's rule.
Len, you've been listening to what has been taking place so far. Would you like to tell us what the situation of working people was at the beginning of the Thatcher era and what it was when her own party threw her out in 1990?
Well, I wouldn't want to pretend that everything was perfect, everything in the garden was lovely.
Of course not.
The charge I make against Margaret Thatcher is this, it's on two scores. She completely failed to accept that untypical things, bricks being dropped off motorway bridges, etc., were totally untypical and were as much opposed by and condemned by the trade union movement as anything else. And secondly, she quite deliberately chose to use unemployment to weaken, to intimidate, to frighten people into submission. Mrs. Thatcher, I'm sorry to say, did more than any other individual to put more people in hock to benefit than any other person in our recent history.
We must now call the defence, John Ridley.
Can you tell us what was so wrong with offering trade union members the right to decide for themselves in a secret ballot whether to go on strike or not?
I don't object to that at all. At the time I was worried about it because I thought that if people had the right to vote whether to go on strike, they should also have the right to vote whether they should go off strike.
Well, we're delighted we've got so much common ground. Lord Murray, Thatcherite reformer of trade unions. This is very good progress indeed.
Mrs. Thatcher, if she'd been prepared to sit down with us, but she refused to meet us to discuss these things.
Well, now, can you also tell us why so many trade union members voted Conservative not once, but in three successive elections and said they liked her reforms? Can you explain
quite
why
right.
that was?
I will give Mrs. Thatcher this point, if you like. That I think that in 1979, she understood that many trade unionists were fed up with the action of other trade unionists.
Yes,
and I think this was right.
Well, I'm delighted.
She was more sensitive than we were at that time.
Well, I'm delighted. And can I give you the opportunity now to apologise to the British people on behalf of your friends and supporters for the winter of discontent, for the lack of caring we saw on offer in 78-9. Would you like to take advantage of this opportunity?
I'm prepared to apologise for anything generically which trade unions as a whole did. I will not apologise for the extreme actions of particular groups of people in particular places, but what I do deeply regret was that Mrs. Thatcher showed an uncaring and unlovely attitude towards the British people in the way that she adopted discrimination against us.
Len Murray, thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Now, defence, it's your opportunity to call your witness.
I call Eddie Shah.
Former newspaper proprietor Eddie Shah was the first businessman to use Margaret Thatcher's new labour laws to take on a powerful union.
Can you tell me what it was like dealing with the trade unions before Margaret Thatcher reformed them?
Yes. Mr. Murray, I'm sorry I have to disagree with you. In 1983, when we had our Warrington dispute, we had nearly 10,000 pickets a night for nearly 7.5 months. They sent coffins around to my house as a warning. They threatened my staff, and there were only 150 of us, and they just kept on and on and on. They tried at one stage to burn down our house, and never at one stage, Mr. Murray, who was continually on television, did he ever stand up and say they shouldn't be doing that? He was asked to do it, and you never ever did it.
Strikers.
Absolutely wrong. You never did it, and you would have let us die because of it. Because at one stage they tried to burn the factory down, and there were people in there who would not have got out.
secret.
That's what trade unions were doing in those days.
B. Campbell for the prosecution, your questions.
Thatcher's trade union legislation, in a certain sense, created people like you, didn't it? It created.
Can I ask what sort of person I am? I'm sorry. What do you mean, people like me? I asked that question because I sold my house. We started a business.
I meant,
over 2,000 jobs.
Buccaneering.
Now, what do you mean? What do you mean by people like me? And do you agree with the racist comments I used to get from Mr. Murray's trade union?
A compliment. You became one of those emblematic employers of the early 80s. Someone who's, if you like, the environment in which you became an employer. The extraordinary wealth that you accumulated.
Yes. And created. Did you create 2,000 jobs from nothing? Did you take the risk to do that? And is that a crime to have done that? Is that a crime?
B. Campbell, your question.
My answer to you is, if one final
I
thing,
haven't asked you a question
is you
yet.
Shouldn't confuse the early days
yet.
Of Thatcher
Why
with the later days of Thatcher.
Why would you let me ask you a question? Would you prefer a world in which employers were free to move unencumbered by trade unions?
No.
Why?
But the trade unions have to show balance as well.
Why would you want a world in which there are trade unions?
I have been a trade unionist in my life. What I objected to under Mr. Kaufman's government very much was they actually allowed the trade unions who were not elected to the country to run the country.
Why do workers need
that
trade
was
unions?
Wrong.
Why do workers need trade unions?
I think it is different to say why do they need them now and why did they need them 50 years ago. It's a totally different environment.
You choose. Why do workers need trade unions?
I think the day is coming where you don't actually need them anymore.
Would you? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eddie Shah. Thank you very much, Eddie Shah. Prosecution.
I called Gerald Ratner.
Gerald Ratner, with his nationwide chain of jewellery shops, thrived during the Thatcher years.
Welcome, Mr. Ratner, and I promise you that I shall not browbeat you in the way the defence people browbeat our witnesses, and I'm sure that you will not browbeat us in the way that the previous witness blustered his way through his session with the Campbell. I would like to ask you, Mr. Ratner, if you will explain to us your view of what took place during the Thatcher years.
Well, I was running the business for about 15 years up until Mrs. Thatcher came into power. And it was a difficult time. Business is about taking risks the whole time. And we felt that the government that was in power at the time, the Wilson government, Healey, yourself, we couldn't really trust. So we felt very uncomfortable. A government doesn't make a business or break a business. You've got to do that yourself. But you really do want the situation, the climate, to be right before you expand. And it certainly was right when Mrs. Thatcher came into power for us.
May I remind you about what you yourself said about the jewellery that you yourself sold? We even sell a pair of earrings for under £1, which is cheaper than a prawn sandwich from Marks and Spencer. But I have to say the earrings probably won't last as long. We also do four sherry decanters, complete with six glasses on a silver-plated tray that your butler can serve you drinks on, all for £4.95. People say, how can you sell this for such a low price? I say, because it's total crap. Isn't it a fact, Mr. Ratner, that what you very honestly described as your approach to jipping working people out of their hard-earned money was exactly the approach in politics of the Conservative
government? That's absolute nonsense. That's a total and complete nonsense. We had 50% of the jewellery market in the UK, and I can assure you that you don't achieve that by selling substandard products. You've been reading too many newspapers. I made a comment about one particular item. Now, you've got 5,000 policies in the Labour government when you were in government. I'm sure that one or two of yours were crap, but you wouldn't turn around and say that.
What you have admitted, and it's the essence of Thatcherism, was that you told working people that they were getting jewellery, and in your own words, they were getting total crap.
No, you've got that wrong. What I said was that the sherry decanter was crap. I said the other stuff was quality products. And I can tell you that you do not get 50% of the market by selling crap to everybody. People are not that stupid.
Right. I think we should bring in the defence. Bruce Anderson.
You may or may not remember that in 1983, just after the election, a very senior member of Labour's front bench described their manifesto as the longest suicide note in history. Now, this same member of the front bench had been trying to persuade the British people to vote for this suicide note. You were honest in public about the nature of one of your products. Mr. Kaufman tried to mislead the entire British people about his entire range of products.
Your question, Bruce Anderson.
What? You came from a pretty ordinary background, didn't you? And was that any disadvantage to success in the Thatcher years?
It wasn't a disadvantage. I mean, we were streetwise. We gave the products. We sold products which we felt that people wanted. We were opening up a lot of shops at the time. We were expanding, and we were putting young people into the deep end, and they were earning good money, and they were very happy at the time, and we were creating jobs.
Roughly how many jobs?
We employ 25,000 people.
Gerald Ratner, thank you very much indeed for your testimony. Bruce Anderson.
I'd like to call an unusual witness who can't unfortunately be here in person, but who will help to remind you how vital Mrs. Thatcher's trade union reforms were.
When we do become the Labour government, the first important task should be to take the media, television and press into common ownership, so it begins to reflect our point of view rather than the opposition.
A mate of yours, Gerald Kaufman?
They were the Tory party's best friends. The Tory government, Margaret Thatcher, created an adventurer playground for irresponsible people of the hard left who had no interest in the interests of the people but were perfectly happy to give Margaret Thatcher her opportunities, as you will see when we get another witness later on.
After the break, was Margaret Thatcher's talk of popular capitalism and a share-owning democracy all it was cracked up to be? Central to Margaret Thatcher's economic and social agenda was her belief in rolling back the frontiers of the state. Not only did this have economic benefits, it also had a moral purpose.
We're told that all we care about is loads of money. Because we give people the chance to better themselves, they accuse us of encouraging selfishness and greed. What nonsense! The truth is, that what we are actually encouraging is the best in human nature. The prosperity brought about by our policies offers a wider choice to more people than ever before. Is this materialism? Is this a selfish society? Are these the hallmarks of greed? The fact is that prosperity has created not the selfish society, but the generous society.
The philosophy was most apparent in the sale of council houses and the privatisation of state-run industries. Defence, your witness.
I have pleasure in calling Claire Spottiswood.
Claire Spottiswood was the watchdog to British Gas, which was Margaret Thatcher's second biggest privatisation.
Claire, can you tell us what benefits privatisation brought to customers?
I think what has happened through privatisation has been quite extraordinary, because what we now have is the ability to choose who we buy our telephones from, where we buy our telephone services from, where we buy our gas from, where we buy our electricity from. What that means is that we have choice, and therefore if we get shoddy service we can move, and indeed we are in large numbers. In addition to which, of course, it has forced through cost cutting and price reductions, which means that on average, for example, in the gas industry, which I know best, we now hover on average around £150 more than we had at the time of privatisation in the gas industry to spend.
Didn't we all get richer and better off as a result of this great process?
Absolutely, absolutely. And in fact, one of the most telling statistics, I think, is that when these industries were first privatised, we were subsidising them to the tune of something like £300 million. Now those same industries are producing over £5 billion to Exchequer in dividends, in interest payments, and in tax payments to the Treasury.
Prosecution, your question, please.
Can you tell us what benefits privatisation brought to the people who run the privatised industries?
From where I sat, the gas industry had become an extremely complex industry to run. It was an international business where competition was being introduced, and as far as I was concerned, what I wanted for the British public was the best management that we could have. Because frankly, unless we had good management, we weren't going to get good service.
Well, you dodged my question. Will you tell us what you think about the people who run the gas industry and what they pay themselves?
I think this is a really old question. I haven't heard anyone complain about the salaries of the British gas industry is no longer an issue because they are a competitive industry.
It's an issue. I think it's an issue to a number of people here tonight. And I'd like you to give a straight answer, if you're capable of doing so, to my question. What do you think of the seven-figure sums that some of these people are paying themselves?
I'm not going to defend all the salaries in the privatised industries. However, I do believe that if we are going to get good service from these industries, we have to have good management. And you have to go out into the market and buy those good managers, because otherwise they won't work in the utility industries.
Claire Spotswood, thank you very much indeed. Now, prosecution, your turn now to call your own witness, please.
I call Chris Holmes.
Chris Holmes runs the charity for the homeless shelter and was housing director for the Inner London Borough of Camp.
The right to buy your council house was probably one of the most popular of Thatcher's initiatives.
Well, it was very popular, and over 1 million people benefited during the 1980s. But those who benefited were the people already well housed, mostly people who had the more attractive houses with gardens. The people who lost, the have-nots, were people in the poorer housing, on the waiting lists, and people desperate for a home. And my central criticism is that the money from the right to buy, from the sales, was not used to replace the homes that have been sold in order to give opportunities for those who are poorly housed.
John Redwood, your questions, please.
Do you own your own home?
Yes, I do.
Why do you want to deny other people the opportunity on lower incomes to enjoy the benefit that you enjoy on a higher income?
I don't. I support home ownership and believe it should be encouraged. My criticism, you recall, was that the houses were sold at cut-down prices to the better-off, the haves, and weren't used to benefit the have-nots by using the money to replace those homes. And one of the consequences of that, one of the consequences was a dramatic increase in homelessness. The number of families in temporary accommodation increased tenfold over those years.
But why do you think the house is destroyed? Because the tenant becomes the owner.
Because the homes, they're not destroyed, but it's reducing
still
the supply.
Lived in by the same
it's
people.
Reducing the supply of homes that
it's
become
not
available
still lived
over
in
time.
By exactly the
could
same
I answer
people.
Your question, please? It reduces the supply of homes that become available for people in housing need.
Are you now saying that all those people on quite low incomes who were entitled to decent discounts that they could enjoy the pride in ownership that you and I have enjoyed for many years were being greedy and unreasonable doing that? I think they were right. I think it was great they got those homes at sensible prices. And don't you agree that it's better to have a home of your own in old age rather than having to pay the rent bill in perpetuity?
People who bought were benefiting, and it's understandable why people took advantage of that. But the cost of that, the cost was those who were homeless and on the housing waiting lists, the have-nots, who didn't have a choice as a result of those divisive policies. That's the charge, and that's the evidence from all my experience during those times working with homeless people and seeing the human misery.
We enfranchised hundreds of thousands of people to enjoy what you and I also enjoy. And I'm glad we gave those people that chance. I'm glad they took advantage of it. And your argument is quite wrong, because we didn't destroy the houses, we let people own them instead.
I didn't suggest that the homes were destroyed. What I said was people were enfranchised. People were able to buy their homes, but those who suffered were the had-nots, the people in desperate need, who in shelter we worked with. The increase in homelessness was irrefutable. A tenfold increase of homeless families in bed and breakfast, people living years in accommodation without the stability for families' life. Those were the poorest, those were the most vulnerable, and those were the people who suffered as a result of misguided housing policies that didn't give equity to people who needed it.
Chris Holmes, thank you very much. Now, Margaret Thatcher's belief was that it wasn't just the rich who benefited from freeing up enterprise, but that it would trickle down to all. Prosecution, could I have your next witness, please?
I call Gabrielle Cox.
Gabrielle Cox has lived in Manchester's deprived Moss Side for 20 years and now works for the Low Pay Unit.
We think of Moss Side and we think of a place living on the hard edge. What have you seen happen to you, to this community over the last two decades?
What has broken my heart was the way in which the members of that community lost hope, lost the sense that their young people had any future. We saw young people themselves feeling that they weren't wanted by the society which they'd thought they belonged to. And we've seen whole communities suffering from poverty, from unemployment, and as a result of that, increases in things like marriage breakdown, suicide, mental health, rises in problems of infant mortality, mortality rates generally.
Margaret Thatcher has promised, or did promise, that she would, that the benefits of wealth creation would cascade to the most impoverished. Where did it land in Moss Side?
It didn't land. To the extent that any of the money that went into Moss Side benefited anybody, it benefited the people who parachuted in. The consultants and those people who make money out of advising the inner city how it ought to live.
Good moment to bring in the defence. Bruce Anderson.
Would you agree that wealth creation is more important than wealth redistribution?
No, I wouldn't. I think wealth creation is important because we need to create wealth.
But I'm quoting but I from think Stephen... Wealth,
I don't care what Stephen Byers said, you ask me. I believe that a good society, a society which values itself, which can hold its head up high, is one that values all its citizens. It's what the Catholic Church calls the common good. And unless we are prepared to share, unless we're prepared to say those who are suffering hard times will gain something from social insurance or taxes, because we know, who knows tomorrow which of us might need it, unless we're willing to share, unless we're willing to say we are a society which cares for all, then we are not a society worth living in. Yeah. And I believe
Do you remember the Hume Estate in central Manchester?
I know the Hume Estate extremely
right, and
well.
You know it was pulled down and replaced by attractive red brick, low-rise housing, the sort of housing people want to live in. Who paid for that to be done? The Thatcher government.
Yes, and the Hume Challenge money was a competitive bid. Hume won the money and other cities lost out. All of Margaret Thatcher's policies were based on competition.
Well, why not?
If you won, as Hume did, you were fine. If you lost, as many cities didn't, you got nothing.
But
and that is the indictment of Margaret
But surely
Thatcher.
Gabrielle Cox, thank you very much indeed. Bruce Anderson, your next witness for the defence, please.
I call Rabbi Emmanuel Jacobowitz.
Emmanuel Jacobowitz was the chief rabbi throughout Margaret Thatcher's period in office and was ennobled by her.
Now, Lord Jacobowitz, you've known Margaret Thatcher for many years. Would you regard her as a caring person?
Yes, I certainly do. My wife and I invited her to be the guests of a Jewish charity institution which cares for elderly people who are most of them disabled in one form or another, who can give her no possible electoral benefit, certainly no financial benefit in coming, and she spent a couple of hours there simply because she cared.
She will always be associated with ideas such as self-help and individual responsibility. Do you regard those as moral qualities?
Yes, I do. I regard them, in fact, as certainly moral qualities enshrined in the Old Testament to which I subscribe, and therefore I greatly believe that this is a moral virtue to work for society and not to take things for granted, not to let just others work for you, but to see your own purpose of life in helping others, in raising the level of others, and therefore in giving expression to the manner in which you care for them, to me this is a moral virtue.
Gerald Kaufman, your questions for the prosecution, please.
Lord Jakubowicz, you described your own pleasant social relationship with Lady Thatcher, and you also described how she was generous enough to spend 2 hours with poor people who depended on charity. Isn't it a fact that under Margaret Thatcher, a very great many more people had to depend on charity because state services were taken away from them?
I will not be able to answer this because I'm not a social historian or a social worker. All that I can say is I was asked to explain from my personal knowledge of her, my occasional encounters with her, does she care or does she not care? And my impression is that she is, personally speaking, a deeply caring person.
For a couple of hours, yes. Let me offer you two statistics. One statistic was that when she became prime minister, the incomes of the richest 20% were four times as large as those of the poorest 20%. By the time her party threw her out, the number of the richest 20% was six times as large as that. Do you regard that as justifiable?
No, I didn't. I wasn't asked to comment on these statistics. Now that you do ask me, let me say I could quote to you any number of statistics to deny this claim and to show how, in numerous respects, she proved to be a deeply caring person. And that there are lies in all statistics.
Lord Jakubowicz, thank you very much indeed for your testimony. Thank you, Gerald Kaufman. After the break, we look at Margaret Thatcher's legacy, and our audience will decide whether she is guilty or innocent of betraying the British people. So, what is Margaret Thatcher's legacy to the British people? Defence, please call your witness.
With some wry amusement at the way fortune's wheel revolves, it gives me pleasure to call Derek Hatton to the witness stand.
Elected a councillor on the day Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister, Derek Hatton became notorious for his militant activities in Liverpool.
Derek, I think from your reception, you have support from both wings in this argument.
Frightening.
Depending on which part of your life we're examining. But I would like you to tell us how you think Margaret Thatcher will go down in the history books.
I think it has to be acknowledged that whether you loved or hated Margaret Thatcher in the 80s, and I not only hated her, but also went down in history as probably fighting her as much as anybody else in this country did. It also has to be acknowledged that when the history books are written, that she will also go down as probably the most successful peacetime Prime Minister of the century.
And would you like to tell us what you think would have happened if she had failed?
And I'll tell you that, and I'll also say that the fact that I say she's the most successful, I mean she's the most successful in terms of what she herself expressed she wanted to do and what she finally achieved. That's not necessarily saying it was the best for the country at that time. What it's saying is that what she did was she paved the way for what we've now got. But the one certain thing is that Tony Blair and his government now would not be in existence had it not been for Margaret Thatcher.
And would you say that you and many like you would not have had such a good life if you had actually won those awful disputes with militants?
I think it depends when I answer that question. If I answered that question in the 80s, I'd have said it would have been far, far better had Margaret Thatcher lost and had we have won. The reality is the match was played, she won the match and we lost the match. And it's no good now crying over spilt milk. It's no good now saying, isn't it a shame we lost? We did lose.
B. Campbell for the prosecution.
Probably everybody would agree that, with you, that Margaret Thatcher was one of the most remarkable prime ministers of the century. But you helped her succeed, didn't you? What I'm suggesting is that if the kind of politics that you stood for, and more generally, socialism, is dead, you were one of the people who gave it the kiss of death.
I would argue that the people who are responsible for giving socialism the kiss of death was not those people who fought to the end against Margaret Thatcher, but those who pretended throughout the 70s and 80s that they were going to support the fight against Margaret Thatcher, and at the end of the day, turned and now are inheriting the political rewards of what she did.
Aren't the people in your city inheriting the political reward of what you gave them, which was a bullying, undemocratic, authoritarian way of organising and expressing socialist politics?
If you ask those people
at the time... It wasn't very clever, was it?
If you ask those people at the time, we actually never, ever lost an election. We won every election. It took the House of Lords to remove us. I don't remember many people voting for the House of Lords. Secondly, 5,000 houses, and I'm talking about red brick houses with gardens back in front, were built more than twice the number of any other city in the country. They are still there, not graffitied and not vandalised. But hang on, just a moment. And while I don't mind answering any questions you give, I thought the idea of tonight was Margaret Thatcher on trial, not Derek Hatton on trial.
Well,
thank you, Derek Hatton. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, B. Campbell. That prosecution, I believe you would like to call some video testimony.
Yes.
Why don't you, instead of asking me questions, oh, are they going to get any more oil? Oh, there are a lot of unemployed here. Why don't you say, look, 80% are in work. Yes, we have to try to get work for 20% of odd. And the work, some of the work that is being done is fantastically successful. Don't you think that's the way to persuade more companies to come to this region and get more jobs as I want them for the people who are unemployed? Not always standing there as moaning minis. Now stop it.
Gerald Kaufman, your witness.
I call Edwina Curry.
Edwina Curry was the Minister for Health for 2 years under Margaret Thatcher.
Edwina, when you came into the House of Commons in 1983, you were regarded as a thoroughgoing Thatcherite, possibly a future Conservative Prime Minister yourself.
Gerald, you say the nicest possible things. Carry on, I'm enjoying this.
I'm coming to my question now, Edwina. And having said all that, you were a member of her government, you supported her. I think you still support a lot of what she did. But what went wrong?
Something very strange happened about 1989, the 10th anniversary of Margaret's becoming Prime Minister of the country. And I think what really went on was that she almost began to believe her own propaganda. In the early years, she had listened very hard. She would give you just a few minutes, but you could get across a point of view, you could throw a few facts at her, and you would hear her using those facts a few days later in debate in the House of Commons, so you knew she was taking it in. But somewhere around 1989, she began to feel that having won all those elections on her gut instincts, which so many people had opposed, only her gut instincts mattered. Now, I represented a marginal seat in the Midlands, an industrial seat. And by the spring, summer of 1989, the recession was beginning to bite. And several of us went to see Margaret, quietly. We didn't make a fuss. We went to see her. And what we got back was 45 minutes of tirade about how dare we say there was a recession. There was a load of nonsense. And we were the moaning minis. And I tell you, Gerald, we were very, very angry about that. I couldn't go back to my local people, my local business people, and say to them, your unemployment is a mirage, because it wasn't.
Don't you think it is a bit peculiar that Mr. Hague, the leader of the Conservative Party, is now engaged in repudiating all of the Thatcher years?
Well, I don't know. If there's anything going on in William Hague's head, I think you'd better ask him about it. What was very upsetting, though, was that we were the party of business, we had encouraged enterprise, and we didn't need to have what ended up as the worst recession in 60 years. If Margaret had listened and not been really so aggressive to us and showed us the door. We were the Tories, and we were very much her supporters. If she'd taken that on board, I think she would possibly have survived.
John Redwood.
Edwina, are you saying that everything that Margaret Thatcher did was fine for 10 years and it was just 1 year at the end that you weren't very happy with?
I think most of what Margaret got up to was not only fine, but revolutionary. If she had continued to operate, nevertheless, by continuing to listen very carefully to lots of diverse voices, instead of just sticking to this, I am Margaret Thatcher, I am great stuff, which in the end, I think was her downfall, we would not have had so bad a recession, we wouldn't have had the poll tax, and we might have had more responsible policies on something you and I disagree about on Europe.
But looking at the charge before this jury tonight, the charge is that the inequalities got worse, the evidence points in the opposite direction. You're saying that for 10 years, presumably, it actually got better rather than worse. Is that right?
The inequalities got worse, but the poor got richer. So the gap got bigger, but the poor also rose.
So you agree that the poor got better?
Right. No, yes. You're both right. And it's a question of what kind of society you want.
Well, am I also right in thinking that you always recommended in every general election from 1979 up to and including 97 that people should vote Conservative?
I was a candidate myself either in local elections or in parliamentary elections at the time.
Edwina, to summarise, you recommended voting Tory and you think that was the right thing to do?
Yes, but whether it will continue
thank you very much.
Is a different matter.
Edwina Curry, confusingly dressed in red. Thank you very much. Bruce Anderson.
I call David Marsland.
Professor of Health Studies at Brunel University, David Marsland is better known as Margaret Thatcher's favourite sociologist.
It was a remarkable achievement, wasn't it, David? She boosted the private sector and she spent a lot more money in the public sector.
Absolutely right. Only in Britain could the media be putting Margaret Thatcher on trial. Anywhere else, if they'd been lucky enough to have a leader of this calibre, they'd have been celebrating her. Across the board of all the policies that we've looked at, privatisation, control of the unions, enterprise, every single one of them, the Labour Party, recognising that socialism was a dead duck, has settled for after having condemned them for years, and they're now putting them into operation.
You'd also agree, David, wouldn't you, that all social groups increased their wealth and improved their living standards during the 1980s?
One of the most disappointing things this evening for me is to hear the same old people parroting the same nonsense about poverty and inequality that I've had to argue about on radio and television programs for 15 years. Inequality as such doesn't matter. What matters is that we all move forward and upward together. And we are doing, and that's what socialists can't bear.
She always said that it was only successful capitalist economies that could create the resources for good public services. And she proved it. She spent more money.
Absolutely. Financial and moral resources. Only under capitalism can you get people to energise themselves and to move forward as we have in the West. And look at the East.
Now, prosecution, your questions, please.
Hello.
Hello, B.
At risk of boring you, tell us what you think about the conditions of and what to do about a third of children pauperised. What do we do about a quarter of our population who are now deemed poor by European standards?
Depends who's doing the deeming.
What would you do?
All they do is define as poor those relative to a moving upwards average. Most of the whining about poverty, not by the poor themselves, but by people like you who earn money from it, is sheer fiction. Sheer fiction.
Nice.
As far as there are some genuinely poor, most of those are created by the collapse of the family, which has been encouraged by the welfare state. If we could only get some self-reliance built by Tony Blair into the welfare state, we would then begin to save families, there would be self-reliance and poverty would be reduced, not to nothing, but even further.
Okay, let's get to the core of this. You probably, more than many, were very close to what Margaret Thatcher actually thought and actually wanted. What do you think she wanted and what do you want in terms of the welfare state? Do you want a welfare state at all?
No, I think the welfare state was a silly label, and the the Conservatives were foolish to settle for it.
So should it be got rid of?
What we want, yes, what we want is a welfare society. That's to say, a society where most people look after themselves, and when and where the temporary minority, changing minority, which might include you or me from time to time, can get the help that they need.
From charity.
Thank you. Professor Martin, thank you very much for your
thank you.
Right, well now listen, before we go to our closing statements, let us first hear Margaret Thatcher's own response to our charge when it was put to her the very day she stood down as Prime Minister and as leader of the Conservative Party.
Over her 11 years, the gap between the richest 10% and the poorest 10% in this country has widened substantially.
All levels of income are better off than they were in 1979. But what the Honourable Member is saying is that he would rather the poor were poorer, provided the rich were less rich. That way you will never create the wealth for better social services as we have.
We have heard the case for and against Margaret Thatcher. But before our audience decides, we'll hear a brief closing statement. First, B. Campbell for the prosecution.
The case against Margaret Thatcher is palpably proven. Her first speech as Prime Minister promised harmony and hope. And what she gave us was a war. She went to war against the majority of the people, the neighbours, the pupils, the students, the workers, the people, us. She regarded us as the enemy within. Thatcher and Thatcherism was never about a unified, healed society. It was always really about the thing that she really wanted, power. Having it, holding it, prizing it, she adored it. She flourished when she had it. Paradoxically, Margaret Thatcher appeared strangely and suddenly most human the moment she lost it.
Bruce Anderson, your closing statement for the defence, please.
She came from a grocer's shop and there she learned her values. She knew that individuals could only thrive out of hard work and that the same was true of nations. That was her great legacy to the British people. That's why every social group in this country got richer during the 1980s. That was why we had the best record of job creation in the whole of Europe. That was why she had a set of policies, Thatcherism, that are now followed throughout the civilized world and beyond. And that concept, Blairism, is just an illegitimate son of Thatcherism. It's Thatcherism with some new spin doctors. She was never all that good at being spun. She was too sincere. And finally, what she did, she put the great back into Great Britain.
So now, members of the jury, our audience of 250, drawn from across the country, it is time for you to reach your verdict. A fascinating moment. Tonight, Margaret Thatcher is charged with betraying the British people by promoting greed over compassion, the haves over the have-nots, leaving a country divided. Now, if you are convinced that she is guilty, I shall be asking you to vote yes. If you regard the verdict as not proven beyond reasonable doubt, you have to acquit her. So, members of the jury, what is your verdict on Margaret Thatcher? Please vote yes or no now. All the votes appear to be in, so on the 20th anniversary of Mrs. Thatcher's election to power, the people have delivered their verdict. Margaret Thatcher is guilty of the charge of betraying the British people. So the people will clearly remember the Thatcher years as a period when Britain lost its heart and the poor paid the price. I'd like just on your behalf to thank the advocates on both sides, and especially you, the audience, for your verdict tonight. Thank you and good night.
Margaret Thatcher won time and time and time again.
She quite deliberately chose to use unemployment to weaken, to intimidate.
A tenfold increase of homeless families in bed and breakfast, people living years in accommodation without the stability for families.
She is, personally speaking, a deeply caring person.
She will also go down as probably the most successful peacetime Prime Minister of the century.